Macmillan Audio presents Bill O'Reilly's Legends and Lies, The Civil War by David Fisher. Introduction by Bill O'Reilly. Read for you by Robert Petkoff.
Introduction. If you are a history buff like me, you'll like to learn new things. The Civil War has been written about so many times, it's hard to even contemplate what has not been said. Yet, legends and lies persist about the war between the states. Myths were created, and today some remain intact, even though the truth is out there. This big audiobook lays it all out. What really happened, and what is fiction? That's the beauty of the legends and lies concept. David Fisher, who composed the words you will soon hear, is a master at painting a vivid historical picture. As you may know, the Civil War was perhaps the most important conflict in our nation's history because we would not have a country as we know it today if the South had prevailed. And the Confederate forces almost did win, led by the brilliant commander Robert E. Lee. You will soon get to know Lee and his Union counterpart, Ulysses S. Grant. Very different men fighting for causes that, at times, weighed on them with extraordinary ferocity. The brutal intensity of the fighting is staggering. Most of the combatants were boys or men just out of their teens. If wounded, they could expect little help. If captured, well, the ordeal was hellish. The South in particular could barely feed its own army, much less Northern prisoners. But amid all the chaos, heroes emerged, on both sides. We will tell you about them. The villains, too. And then there were the slaves, human beings bought and sold. Even though some believe the Civil War was primarily about the rights of individual states to determine their societies, the true emotional nature of this war was freedom for black people. Frederick Douglass was an African-American who attained freedom but could not rest until his brethren did the same. What a compelling human being, Frederick Douglass. You will also learn about the bravery of Abraham Lincoln, who aged dramatically during the war. His empathy for the suffering soldiers and slaves is what sets him apart from most politicians. Lincoln is a towering figure, perhaps our best president. You will see how he himself suffered over the years, knowing that victory was not assured. In fact, we spend a good amount of time on the battle that saved Lincoln and the Union, Gettysburg. That incredible fight remains the most important battle ever fought on American soil. And to the very end, the outcome was in doubt. The listener of this audiobook will experience that battle as it was actually fought, not romanticized or sanitized. We will take you to southern Pennsylvania for a listening experience you will not soon forget. The relevance today of legends and lies will unfold before your ears. We are living in a time of conflict. Terrorists overseas want to kill us. Politics at home can be vicious. We are a divided nation, as the presidential election of 2016 demonstrated. Sometimes emotions between citizens run high, and there have even been violent political protests. And when we see these on television, it might be wise to think back to the 1860s, when the country fractured and Americans killed one another, sometimes in savage displays. That kind of thing will never happen again, but for the aware American, it is important to understand why it did happen once upon a time. The war between the states shaped attitudes for decades, and to this day, there are reverberations from the carnage. The Black Lives Matter movement, for example, bases its call for social justice on slavery and the massive abuse it caused. As for free men, millions of Americans on both sides had their families shattered by death during the bloodiest war in American history. So, There is much to know about the Civil War, and you are about to absorb many things. No longer will the conflict be a fable or a movie. Listening to Legends and Lies will provide you with a factual picture of an American tragedy that led to triumphs decades later. The true nature of freedom was defined during the Civil War, and all of us carry that freedom today as we live life in America. David Fisher and I are proud of this audiobook and very glad you have chosen to listen to it. Bill O'Reilly, February 2017, New York City. 1. A Grave Beginning. John Brown stirs America's passions. On Sunday, October 16, 1859, John Brown and his band of 21 men came out of the dark night to change American history. The terror of all Missouri, as the New York Times had called the 59-year-old abolitionist, was known nationally as a leader of the anti-slavery movement and a zealot who had murdered at least 5 pro-slavery men in cold blood. His stated purpose that night was to seize the federal armory and its thousands of weapons in the quiet town of Harper's Ferry, Virginia, expecting it to be the spark that ignited a rebellion of slaves in the region. In fact, he would start a war that would inflame the entire nation. While history records that the Civil War began early in the morning of April 12, 1861, when Confederate troops began shelling Union-occupied Fort Sumter in Charleston, South Carolina's harbor, many historians believe war became inevitable the night of John Brown's raid. Today, Brown is remembered mostly for the verse, "John Brown's body lies a-moldering in the grave, his soul is marching on," but his daring raid at Harper's Ferry put the nation on the path that would lead to the bloodiest war in American history. When abolitionist John Brown was hanged for his attempt to ignite a slave rebellion, Ralph Waldo Emerson wrote that his execution would make the gallows as glorious as the cross. Decades earlier, the Founding Fathers had successfully managed to weave together the 13 colonies into a nation without resolving the momentous debate over slavery. Since an English ship, the White Lion, sailing under a Dutch flag in 1619, had traded the first 20 enslaved Africans to the Jamestown colonists in exchange for food and supplies, Americans had wrestled with the moral and economic implications of treating human beings as property. The agrarian South, with its tobacco economy, relied on slave labor far more than the industrialized North. In 1780, Pennsylvania became the first state to begin banning slavery, passing a law that moved exceedingly slowly toward emancipation. After long and bitter debates that threatened to tear apart the newly won country, the delegates attending the 1787 Constitutional Convention passed the 3/5 compromise, which counted slaves as 3/5 of a person when determining a state's representation in Congress, but gave those slaves no rights. Slaves were property to be bought, sold, and worked until they died, and all of their children were born into slavery. With schoolteacher Eli Whitney's 1793 invention of the cotton gin, the so-called engine that could rapidly clean seeds from raw cotton, cotton replaced tobacco as the South's most profitable crop and required even more slaves to pick it. America's 1790 census recorded almost 700,000 slaves, a number that increased by more than 500,000 in the next 2 decades. By 1850, it was estimated there were more than 3 million slaves in the United States, and 1 in 4 Southerners owned slaves. While New England's textile industry had once depended on slave labor, the northern states had mostly abolished slavery by 1804, although in some cases the statutes remained legally in force. In 1808, Congress outlawed the importation of slaves from Africa, but the domestic slave trade, the exchange of existing slaves and their families, continued to flourish in the South. The Missouri Compromise, passed in 1820, arranged a tenuous peace between pro- and anti-slavery interests by dividing the 22 states equally into slave and free states. But while Northern politicians continued to speak out publicly and most ineffectually against slavery, others began taking covert action. The abolitionist movement created the Underground Railroad, a vast network of way stations consisting of hiding places in caves and in cellars, beneath church floors and in barn lofts, through which conductors guided escaping slaves trying desperately to make their way north to freedom. Among these conductors and station masters were legendary figures such as Harriet Tubman, an escaped slave who risked her life leading hundreds of others to freedom, as well as common folk such as the parents of teenager James Butler Wild Bill Hickok, whose small farm in Homer, Illinois, served as a way station. The penalties for working on this railroad were severe. The Fugitive Slave Act of 1850 made it a federal crime to assist escaping slaves and included large fines and possible imprisonment for offenders. In 2020, Harriet Tubman, an escaped slave who led hundreds of others to freedom on the Underground Railroad, will become the first woman since Martha Washington to appear on American currency when she replaces slaveholder Andrew Jackson on the $20 bill. England peacefully abolished slavery throughout its empire in 1833, but this peculiar institution, as Southerners referred to it, remained the foundation of the Southern agricultural economy. The issue threatened to rip the country apart. Ralph Waldo Emerson spoke for most Northerners when he said, "I think we must get rid of slavery, or we must get rid of freedom." In 1851, a Connecticut woman named Harriet Beecher Stowe began writing a serial for the anti-slavery magazine The National Era, in which she painted a word picture of slavery based loosely on actual stories. A year later, her more than 41 installment series was published as the two-volume book Uncle Tom's Cabin, or Life Among the Lowly. Its portrayal of the brutal realities of American slavery shocked the world. The book became a bestseller in the United States, Europe, and Asia, eventually being translated into 60 languages. Stage plays based on the story, Tom shows, were immensely popular. By the end of the century, Uncle Tom's Cabin had sold more copies than any book other than the Bible, and it is credited with forcing many Americans to face the true horrors of the slave trade. "I wrote what I did," she explained, "because as a Christian, I felt the dishonor to Christianity, because as a lover of my country, I trembled at the coming day of wrath." Public consciousness had been raised, but still the nation was divided. When Congress passed the Kansas-Nebraska Act in 1854, which allowed residents of those territories to vote to decide whether they would enter the Union as slave states or free states, real fighting finally broke out. The bill, sponsored by Illinois Senator Stephen Douglass, was an attempt at compromise. Instead, it further split Congress between the anti-slavery North and pro-slavery South and caused the demise of the once powerful Whig Party, which in turn led to the formation of the new and strongly anti-slavery Republican Party. And it ignited the long-lasting guerrilla war that journalist Horace Greeley named, sadly, Bleeding Kansas. Pro-slavery gunslingers known as border ruffians or bushwhackers raced into the Kansas Territory from Missouri, where they were met by the equally violent abolitionist Jayhawkers. What has on occasion been called the First Battle of the Civil War took place on May 21, 1856, when as many as 800 men rode into the newly formed anti-slavery town of Lawrence, Kansas, terrified the residents, and destroyed several buildings, although the only fatality was the result of an accident when a building collapsed. For half a century, politicians had been able to find ways to compromise about slavery, but they were running out of solutions. In May 1856, angry words became violent deeds in Congress when pro-slavery Congressman Preston Brooks from South Carolina viciously attacked Massachusetts abolitionist Senator Charles Sumner, smashing him on his head and shoulders with his cane, stopping only when the cane broke into pieces. It took Sumner 3 years to recover from his injuries, while Brooks became a hero in the South and received new canes from his admirers. Abolitionists found their own hero 3 days later in Osawatomie, Kansas. John Brown was the Bible-quoting father of 20 children who had moved to Kansas to fight to end slavery. The son of strict Calvinists, he grew up among mostly Native American families in western Ohio. When he was 12 years old, he watched helplessly as a young slave boy was beaten and forced to sleep in the cold wearing only rags, an experience that he later wrote transformed him into a most determined abolitionist. He helped escaping slaves flee north to Canada.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.